Hello everybody, this is Kid Knot. Today we are going to be doing a amateur alpha team league match against Psionic Aftermath's Yankees versus Law B. This is Kid Knot 01 and we are doing this as the first of a weekly league that they do, and this is my first time, so bear with me just a little bit. We're going to be going against game number one. It is Psionic's Aftermath Yankees against Law B. Law B is a Czech Republic team, and we're going to be hopping into our first match. This is a best of five, so they will be picking their first teammates and starting off here in just a couple of minutes. As soon as we get into game number one, just started off with Psionic Aftermath, so kind of getting used to the overlays and the casting of the production part of it, but once we get into the game, things should be going out pretty smoothly, and just bear with me a little bit. Glad you guys could join us today. Again, this is the Alpha Team League. It's the week number one. And looks like the first game of the tournament today is going to be played on Blackpink. This should be a fun tournament to watch. We've been doing a lot of casting lately. Did some WCS about a month ago, and we do Proxy Tempest Diamond Platinum on the NA server every Tuesday night. So now we're doing some Psionic Aftermath, and been doing a little bit of their practice games. Hey, Xenodactyl, how you doing? That shouldn't be running in the background. I wonder if it's the game sounds that are coming up. Should be getting into game number one. We'll just kind of play a little bit with the sound as we get going through this game number one. Hmm. Looks like we're just waiting for a couple of people to get into the lobby. So again, we'll be getting started here shortly. Trying to get the lobby going here. Okay, going into game number one. Again, this is the Sonic Aftermath Yankees versus La B. Going to be starting on Black Pink. This is a best of five. Hey, thanks, Gorgoth. Appreciate it. Hope I pronounced that right. So, we'll go ahead and do the player introductions. We are playing on Black Pink and spawning in the bottom left-hand corner. Playing for La B, it's our Green Terran player. Playing for Sonic Aftermath, our Green Terran player. It is Daunted. And spawning in the upper right-hand corner, playing for La B, as our pink Zerg player, it is ADIK, Attic. Again, I believe these guys are from the Czech Republic, and obviously in the Green Terran player is from Sonic Aftermath, the Yankees. So, best of five tournament, and looks like the Zerg player for... La B is opening Hatch Gas Pool. You guys let me know if the game sounds okay or my volume is all right. So TVZ, always a fun match to watch. Looks like Donut's going to be opening up probably a Reaper Expand. Going to be expanding on the low ground. This is a really good map for TBZ. It's got a lot of open area. There's quite a large ramp for the Terran to try and wall off, so it's not too bad as far as a choke point if they, you know, try and seize up with mech and stuff like that. So yeah, looks like you were just opened up pretty standard. It's a good macro map. Lots of areas to drop in the main base for your Terran, and he can also move up on this side of the map. There's areas that they can seize up their tanks on both sides here. Got a Reaper going into the main base of our Zerg player. A couple of Lings there to ward that off. Four out with a Queen about halfway ready to spawn. Looks like we got Factory going down for Donned and another barracks. So he's got his second command center just about done. So we got the six Lings that are trying to push the Reaper away. Looks like Donner wants to expand, Attic tried to expand, but the Reaper was actually able to kill off the drone. So just bear with me a little bit on the players. TBZ on Blackpink, yeah, that's rare. So we got a couple of Marines that are taking out the Overlord that was getting a scout, and looks like right now, looks like Donnan might be wanting to go with a 2-1-1. He's got two barracks down, and he's getting stim. Quite a few Lings with speed coming over toward the natural base of Donnan. He does have some Marines there, but there's about eight Lings that are attacking the natural base, trying to get the SCV. He's got a pretty good spot with his Marines. The only thing is, he doesn't shut the supply depot down, so two of the Lings are going to be able to get into the main base, but it doesn't look like they're going to get a lot done. We do have that third base down for Attic, and he's also getting a Baney nest. But that was held off pretty easily. So Stim is about halfway done. He's going to be switching over the starport onto the reactor in order to get his double medevacs out. Baning Nest is now complete for Attic. He's still producing drones and he's getting a lair. He's actually getting a total of four gases. So we'll have to see if he's going to want to go into a roach build or exactly what he's going to be doing. He's putting down an Evo chamber. So double medevac production has begun. So this could be, Attic is making 20 more Lings, and he does have quite a few out on the map already. So, he's got eight Lings. He's making 20 more. So he may just trying to go in and do a banning bus. We have a third command center coming down for Donned. Xenodactyl. Got a double engineering base coming down for Donned. Looks like we got a plus one melee coming in for Attic with a lot of Lings and a lot of Bane. So it looks like he's going to be in pretty good shape to hold that off. Quite a bit of Marines here trying to take down the third hatchery. He's able to get the third hatchery down. He loses about eight Marines in doing so, but he was able to snipe that hatchery down, only losing about half his Marines, and both of his medevacs survived. Yeah, Donner looking pretty good so far. He was only losing the half of his Marines and taking out that third hatchery. It looks like now Attic wants to double expand. We do have double upgrades coming in for Donned. And it looks like plus one melee and baning speed is on the way for Attic. Okay, we'll increase the game sounds a little bit and see how that comes out. So we have the Hydra Den down. Looks like Donnard wanted to do a little bit of a drop into the main base, but that gets shut down. The Hydra Den is done for attic and he's putting down an infestation pit. Third command center for Donut is complete, and he's now flying that over to his third base. And right now the worker supply, Donut is about even with workers, 52 to 53, but he is going to have the power of the mules. So that's definitely going to be helpful. The creep spread is starting to move out pretty well for Attic. He is starting plus two, and he's making some hydras. He actually canceled that extra base that he was going to make, so he actually did not double expand. So right now the drone count is pretty much even. Possibly wanted to go ahead and keep that second hatchery making there so that he could get even on the drone count. Donut is really making a lot of extra drones. You probably should take some of them from the natural base over to the main, because he's definitely oversaturated on the natural base. But overall, Army Supply looks like Attic is up 33 or 44 to 33. Both of them seem to be floating a lot of minerals, and Donut's actually floating about 900 gas. So it looks like he's just trying to get his production facilities up and running so he can spend some of that income. So right now we have a lot of lings that were being made by Attic. He is moving into the third base again with his Marines. He has a small pack of Marines that looks like the Army position for Attic was definitely all into the main base. So he's going to lose one medevac. He is staying there, and the Hydras are actually going to take out the second medevac. So he loses both of his medevacs. The Army was a little bit into the main base and out of range of that third base, but didn't take an awful lot of damage. May have lost a few drones. Yeah, he actually lost about five drones. So that wasn't too bad. He was able to hold that off pretty well. Looks like Donut is able to now start getting some of that production running with all of the income that he has. He's got double factory. He's got four racks in his starport. So he is moving up to the right side of the map with quite a large squad of Marines, and he's got four medevacs. There's quite a few Hydras and Ling Bane for Attic. They're both just getting some pretty good upgrades. It looks like Attic is now getting into some Vipers as he's now on Hive Tech. The only thing is he doesn't have a lot of tanks or anything, so he really isn't going to need those. Now the Bio is there without any tank support, so the Ling Bane were able to move into there and take pretty much all the Marines out. And he's got quite a Hydra force that he's moving up with. The overall Army supply is about even. I think maybe Donut could have used a little bit of tank support with his bio. But now he is getting into some tanks and continuing to get his upgrades. And looks like Attic, he's getting 3-3. He's getting adrenal glands. So he's definitely keeping up with the upgrades. He's got the Ultra Cavern down. He's getting chitinous plating. So he's definitely going to have a strong army here very shortly. Looks like Donut is getting a couple of Liberators. Got his... Actually, he flew over his third command center to his fourth location, and now he's floated his third base to where the... was to begin with. So we've got a total of four bases for both players. Worker supply is still about even, and Donut is actually up on Army supply, 103 to 84, but Attic is actually making some ultralists. So it looks like Donner's moving out onto the map. He does have an awful lot of Marines, but with those ultralists out, once they get chitinous plating, he's actually making four total. He's got quite a few bangs. He's got a lot of Hydra. So Donner's really going to have some really good splits on his Marine, which he is getting some splits, and he's got his Liberators on the map. But we're getting a pretty good surround here from ADK. He's coming up the middle with his Lings and his bangs, and he's actually cleaning everything out. He gets some blinding clouds down. There's a few tanks left, but they're going to be cleaned up easily by Attic there, and he is actually going to take the overall Army supply lead of 105 to 75. So he was able to clean up that Army of Donner pretty easily. Looks like the upgrades are pretty much finished for Attic, and he's actually taking his fifth base. There was a small drop there by the fifth base from Donnett, but that's going to be cleaned up by the Ultralis. Donnett now is getting the Ghost Academy, so he's going to need to get that up to get some snipes off the some of the Ultralis. The overall army supply right now is 110 for Attic and 81 for Donnett. And Donnett is moving again out onto the map. Faye says it's going to be 1-0 for the Dream Team. So Donnett's just posturing a little bit. Trying to get into the right position with his army. He's got a lot of medevacs. He's got 8 in total, and he has got a lot of marauders now to possibly soak up some of the damage by all of those ultralists. Now, he is actually, Donnett actually flew one medevac right over top of the army without doing any type of scan, so he lost a complete full medevac. Worker supply lead is even. They're both pretty much maxed out. Not really building up any type of bank. The creep spread for Attic is pretty good. It's about halfway across the map. Yeah, Faith, he definitely has an awful lot of Marines. This time he does have quite a few Marauders in there. He is getting cloak, and so if he could get some snipes on some of the Ultralists. Right now they're both just kind of posturing in the middle of the map. Looks like Donnett was actually able to take another base, so he's on 5 bases also. So 5-5, and they're both starting to build up a little bit of a bank. Army supply is just about even and pretty much finishing up with their upgrades, and Donnett's putting down 4 more barracks, so hopefully he's going to be able to, he's not going to be able to remax quite as quickly as our Zerg player. A little bit of a Ling run by, but Donnett's going to be able to hold that out fairly easily. The only thing is, it did pull back his entire army. There's another huge Ling run by into the fourth base of Donnett, and that is going to eventually be cleaned up, but he lost a lot of workers in that run by. He lost a total of 26 workers. But again, Donnett is up on army supply. He needs to do a little bit more of a spread here because we do have quite a few Vipers. The Blinding Clouds are really good by Attic there, and he's got the Ultralis that are just trying to rake their way through. But there's an awful lot of Marauders there that were being kited really well by Donnett. He actually gets some snipes off also to take out some of the Ultralis. Yeah, he definitely needs to get some more Liberators and get Liberator range. Attic is making 58 more Lings and a couple more Ghosts coming in for Donnett. So he's trying to get back up his worker count. He still has the Mules, so the overall worker supply really isn't going to make all that much difference. Because with those Mules, he is going to be able to continue to get his production going. Now, he does have a lot of Ghosts out on the field now. He's got 10 Ghosts, and they do have Cloak. He's getting his Liberators. So he's kind of jumped out of tank production and going more into bio. He's actually doing a lot more scans now so that he's able to get into position to see where that army is there. Creep spread continuing to move across the map for Attic. He's got more than half the map covered. Looks like Attic is trying to move forward with all of his Lings and Bangs now. Donnett is on the retreat. He's got all of his Ghosts. He's going to need to get some snipes off. Good Blinding Cloud that's going to be able to take out at least half the forces of Donnett. And with all of those Hydras and Ultralis, it's really actually quite an even fight. But looks like all of the Ultralis are gone, and he's still got a lot of Hydra left. So Attic's army supply is 81-37, but a lot of that is tied up in Vipers and Hydralis. But there's 3 Ultralis left over. So we're just going to have to see if they can hold off the balance of these Hydras. I think there's only one Ultralis left. He's trying to make 14 more Lings and 1 more Ultralis. The overall Army Supply. The Don is down to 22 Army Supply. The Hydras are moving into the third base, and Don is going to have to tap out and call GG. So Law B Attic is able to take game number one. So definitely a good game by both players. Looks like Donna just was taken off guard by all of those ultralists. So Law B takes game number one in this best of five. So I'm glad you guys could join us in chat. Again, this is week number one of our weekly tournaments for the Alpha Team League. Psionic Aftermath Yankees against Law B, which is a Czech Republic team. Be going into game number two shortly. Yeah, definitely. I think Ravens definitely would have helped a lot of Liberators. If he had six or seven Liberators, that would have helped also. The Blinding Clouds were really good, though, by Attic there. So this is the Psionic Aftermath stream. Glad you guys could join us. And we are on EU tonight. So myself, I'm in New York, so I'm. It's fairly early for me, but... A little bit later in the evening for those of you in the EU. Be getting into game number two here shortly. We'll see who the captains pick for game number two. So we're now going to be hopping into game number two. Again, this is a best of five. So game number two is going to be on Neon Violet Square. And looks like Warbuffy's going to be playing against Xenador. Nope, take that back. It's going to be Warbuffy's the captain, so he's just kind of doing the lobby for us. Looks like Mythic is going to be playing against Xenador. You ready to hop into game number two? Yep, it's going to be a Terran versus a Protoss. Again, my name is Kidnat01. Glad you could join us today. Got to bear with me a little bit on the names because I'm unfamiliar with some of these guys, but we'll do the best that we can. And hopping into game number two. Okay, so we have a best of five going into game number two with Law B taking game number one. So we'll go ahead and introduce our players on Neon Violet Square. Spawning in the upper left-hand corner. Playing for Sonic Aftermath, it is Xenadora. Or Xenador. And spawning in the bottom right-hand corner. Playing for Law B, it is Mythic. He is our Red Terran player. So this is kind of an interesting map, especially with Terran and Protoss, because they both have a little pocket expansion that they can take. A little bit lower on minerals, only four mineral patches, but they can get their extra gas. And especially with the Protoss player, it's a little easier for him because he doesn't necessarily have to worry about the drop play. But it's the same thing with the Protoss. He can... not get in there nearly as easily with his warp prism, so it's a little bit safer for the both players to take that third, but again, they don't have the normal mineral patches that they would have when they would take this normal third base, but it is a little bit more exposed through here. Now, the main base, that's protected by the natural, and the ramp here is... pretty small ramp, so both players can kind of siege up, especially the Terran can siege up here on the high ground with some tanks and be pretty protected, so they can actually get three bases fairly easy, even though that the third base in that pocket expansion does only have the four mineral patches, but it does have the full gas. Now, Xenador, he was actually able to get up, and he put a pylon down to... kind of blocked the area where in between the supply depot and the barracks, but the probe was actually able to get over there and put that down, but then the Reaper was able to take the probe out. Now he's working on the pylon. So right now it looks like we have a gateway expand and a couple of adepts being made by Xenador, but now that's actually supply blocked him when that Reaper took out that pylon. So basically, it looks like we have pretty standard opening, Reaper opening for our Terran player, and Xenador just opened up a gateway expand. And now he's putting down a Twilight Council and getting a Stalker. His warp gate is about halfway done, and we have a bunker that coming down for Mythic. And he's basically making some marines, and he's got his factory done. And right now he's actually producing a cyclone, so he's going to go cyclone marine to begin with. The Reaper does make it up into the main base of Xenador, but that was taken out by the Stalker and the Adept. A couple more gateways coming down for Xenador. So he is, actually he's researching Blink, so he looks like he wants to go into a quick Blink, and I think that's pretty common against Terran to go Blink. Now he is, our Terran player Mythic is making some more Marines, and he did get that Cyclone out, taking his second gas, which I'm thinking his gas, the second one was a little bit late, but he only went to one Cyclone, so he's actually taking his... three gases now. Looks like a Robo's coming down for Xenador. Continuing to get his gateway production done. Warp gate is done. So he'll be getting some more Stalkers. And Blink is about two-thirds of the way done. So we got go Xeno. So we got some Xeno hype in here. Got a third base that is coming down for Xenador. So he's really trying to get his macro machine going. So there's Chrono boosting the Blink out and just continue to make probe. Our worker count right now is Xenador is up 36 to 31, but he does have that third base just about done. have the Observer coming out for Xenador and just continue to make Marines. There is one tank out for Methic. So far, pretty standard, although Methic, he is a little bit down on workers, and I don't believe he has a third command center. So, Xenador looks like he's going to be able to take a pretty good economic lead here shortly now that Nexus is going to be done at his third base. And again, this is where I was talking about they could take their third base here or the pocket expansion, but it looks like Xenador has chosen to go with the one with the normal minerals. So right now we're just getting our production going, and Blink is done, and getting some more observers being made by Xenador. Got a couple liberators coming out for Methic, looks like he wants to push across the map a little bit with his Cyclone and tank, and we have the Observer right over top of the army there, so that's going to be spotted with no problem. Yeah, Xeno didn't cannon rush. So we got quite a few Stalkers out for Xenador, and Blink is done. Methic is researching Stim and making another tank and some more Liberators. So looks like he wants to do a lot of this off from two bases, whereas Xenador is going to be on the three bases. He's up 46 to 40 on the worker count. The Stalkers are moving across the map. Now he does know that that army's there. He does have Blink ready. He is also researching Charge. So he could actually Blink right there, and he could take out two of those Liberators. They're not in their siege mode, but he actually Blinks back out. So that was probably a good choice because of the bio and the tanks. Now there's looks like three tanks out and the one Cyclone with a couple of Liberators and some bio. The third command center is now coming down for Methic. I hope I'm pronouncing these names right. The only thing I don't see for Xenador is I don't see any forges, so he's not getting any upgrades. Looks like Methic now wants to push out with these tanks and Liberators. And looks like the army is back. Pretty much back for Xenador. He's got a lot of Zealots there, but that's that siege up that he can put with those Liberators. Now, one Liberator is about half damage. He's got four Liberators. The Stalkers are trying to come in from the rear, but here comes the charge lots. I don't know his charge was done. It's not quite done, but he goes in anyway with the charge lots. It's just about done, but hasn't been completed. He clears up all of the ground, and now he's going to be able to take out all of the Liberators with the Blink Stalkers. So right now, our overall army supply, Methic's down 28 to 45, and his third base was just completed, and Xenador has actually got his third base completely up and running, so he's going to be able to outproduce a little bit from Methic until he gets that second base saturated. Worker supply lead is just about even, but Xenador, he's up a little bit of army supply now. He is putting down the two forges, so he is going to be able to start his upgrades. We have one engineering bay for Methic, so he's actually able to get one of the upgrades out. But charge is now done, so Xenador is trying to come in with a counter in toward the natural base of Methic. They're... This is the area that I was talking about on this particular map where the Terran can seize up with the tanks and his bio, so it's going to be awfully hard to move in for Xenador. So it looks like Xenador is going to try and come in from the gold base to double check there. He's just going to find it a little bit difficult in moving up that ramp. Xenador is taking his fourth base and pretty much even on worker count. Overall army supply, Xenador is up 67 to 59. So we're going to have to see what these guys decide they're going to work into as far as a an army composition because of this map layout. It's just a little bit difficult to move up into that natural ramp of both players. So right now, Xenador is really banking a lot of minerals and gas, so we'll have to see what he decides to do as far as if he changes tech or if he's going to stay on the just kind of the gateway units. He's got a lot of kind of spotter pylons throughout the map, and he does have a warp prism outside of the main base of Methic, and he's got some charge lots. It looks like he's going to send it toward the natural base to distract him. He's got the warp prism going into the main base. He's just now getting outside of the range of the turrets, but he lost a couple of the turrets or the warp prism. He does have a few of the zealots in there, so he only lost one zealot, but really not able to get a lot done. He took out just one of the turrets. It did pull the army back completely from Methic, so just those four zealots was able to pull that back, and now it looks like Xenador wanted to move into the natural base, but again, with the tank and the supply depots there, that's going to be awfully difficult to move into there. Looks like Xenador is now starting to get some upgrades out of the double forge that he put down, and he's actually got his fourth base saturated, so the overall worker count is 52 to 46. So it looks like Xenador was trying to move into that natural base, but he is just not able to get in there with that siege line that Methic had there in the natural base. So he's going to pull back. Let's see what he decides to do as far as production concerning. He probably needs to get off those gateway units and get into some little bit of higher tech. Methic has now taken the overall army supply lead, and he is up on upgrades. Got quite a few marauders and getting some more tanks. So he's definitely going to have a powerful army. Now the gateway units are kind of trying to meet right here in the middle. It looks like Xenador didn't spot where the army was, and now the army of Methic is moving out. Got a blink right into the army of Methic, but those upgrades are able to clean those out. He stims forward, and he's taking out a lot of the stalkers, and they're just not blinking away. Now we do have these little neon violet squares, going to make it a little bit slower to get those up through there, but now the overall army supply is 117 to 73 for Xenador, and this is just one big bio ball that he's moving up. He does have some tanks, and now we're moving up to those to the ramp there. Xenador was actually able to get a couple of Colossus out, but looks like Methic is going to stim right up onto that ramp, and looks like the Zealots were out of position. He's going to stim up, and he's going to try and take out the Colossus. He got one of them, takes out most of the Stalkers, and the overall army supply now is 82 for Methic, and one Colossus is still alive. He's still trying to warp in a bunch of Zealots, and he gets those warped in, and he's trying to push those back. He still has some Stalkers, but he's only got one Colossus left. So the overall supply is now 116 for Methic and 84, and he continues to push up with that bio ball. He's going to stop 2-2 from finishing if he... Oh, he's actually just stimming forward, trying to take out the Colossus. He's trying to get the forges on time. 2-2 did finish, but the overall army supply lead for Methic is just going to be too high. It's 63 to 17. Looks like Xenador is going to have to tap out, and looks like he's going to take game number two. So he's actually pulling the probes away. He's taking down the natural nexus, and he's continuing to rally army supply over to Protoss's side of the base. He moves up into the main base. He's going to hit some of these pylons. Going to shut down all of the gateways. And yeah, looks like Xenador, he's going to have to tap out here in just a moment. And looks like our Czech Republic team is going to take game number two and go up 2-0 in the match. Still have one Colossus and a few Stalkers that Xenador is trying to get up into the base, but it looks like they're just maybe a little bit too much bio. He stims forward, going to take out the last Colossus and the last Stalkers for Xenador, and Xenador calls GG, taps out, and Law Bees Mythic takes game number two, and they take a 2-0 lead in the series. So, yeah, a little bit of a rough start for Cyanic Aftermath. They're down 2-0, but looks like they've run into a bit of a powerhouse here in their Zerg and their Terran player. So we could be going into a match point the next game, but we'll have to see if what the Terran captain does for Cyanic Aftermath Yankees. Glad all of you could join us here on Cyanic Aftermath. This is a weekly Alpha Team League tournament that these guys play, and this week they're playing the Czech Republic Law Bee, and they're going to have to try and do an all kill and pull out 3-0 to get to take the series. Yeah, that was a good game, Zeno. You had a bit of a lag, huh? So we'll be going into game number three in just a moment. So they're asking if this is going to be the all kill. So we got to see if Cyanic Aftermath can come back after down 2-0. I'm just getting ready for the next two players for our third map. So our third game is going to be on Eastwatch. We'll have to see who the captains decide they're going to pick for playing our third map. Cyanic Aftermath's going to try and go in for an all kill, and Law B is going to go ahead and try and take the series 3-0 in this game. Looks like just waiting for one more person to enter the party. We'll be going into game number three. First two games, Law B was looking pretty good. Actually, both teams played really well. They were pretty much both open, even on supply. Yes, definitely. If it does go 2-2 after four maps, there's definitely an ace match. So it looks like game number three on Eastwatch is going to be a another TVP. Got two Masters players playing in this match, so definitely should be pretty evenly matched. That's all right, Zeno. You play a really good game. It's fun to watch. Always fun to watch. I've casted a lot of your games in the other tournaments and so on, so that was definitely a fun game to watch. Unfortunately, didn't go your way that game, but that's no problem. So going into Eastwatch, this is definitely an interesting map. A lot of choke points on this map. Yeah, that's a tough map for Blink Stalkers or anybody in particular because of the neon violet square there, but okay, so going into game number three on Eastwatch, we have Law B that's up 2-0. So spawning in the upper right-hand corner, playing as our green Protoss player, it is Konseek. I'm not quite sure how to pronounce that. Konisek? I'm not sure, but anyway, green Protoss player. And spawning in the bottom left-hand corner, it is our red Terran player. It is John. So glad you guys could join us for our tournament today. It is a best of five, and Law B is up 2-0. A little bit of a harass by the probe onto the onto John's side of the map. He's just kind of harassing an SCV, and one SCV is pulled off by John to shoot that little bugger away. So it looks like John just wants to basically do a Reaper expand, and we have a Gateway expand coming down for Konseek. Connie. So as of right now, it looks like John's just staying on one gas and getting the Reaper out. Got a second command center being built on the low ground. And Konseek is going into his second gas. See what his tech choice is going to be after his cybernetic score is done. Hey, thanks. I appreciate that. A little shout out to the stream here. We always appreciate that. Looks like John's just going to start out with a Marine after a couple of Marines after the Reaper. Now the Reaper is getting into the main base. There is a Stalker there, so he gets just a little bit of a scout, but he wasn't able to see any tech yet because Konseek hadn't put that down yet. So he does get the Reaper out of there. So he is continuing to make Marines and. Looks like just two more gateways coming down from our Protoss player. Well, he actually did put a Stargate down also, so he's getting three gateways and a Stargate. Got a bunker coming down for John, and Factory is done. He's putting down his starport. Reaper's still trying to get up into that main base and get a scout off. He's actually able to get it all the way into the main base. He's got to get over there, and he's got a spot there. He actually did get vision of the Stargate, so he does now know that there's a couple of gateways and a Stargate down. That was an excellent scout by John. Konisek. Okay. Thank you. I appreciate that. Konisek. Okay, so John is getting a couple of turrets up because he does know that Stargate's down, and he is producing an Oracle. So the Oracle is on its way onto the other side of the map. He does have some Marines, and he's got the missile turret, so he's in pretty good shape. Looks like John may want to move across the map with looks like he's got a couple of Widow Mines, so he's going to do a Widow Mine drop. So right now it looks like Terran player, he's getting stim, he's making tanks. There is a Twilight Council going down for Konisek. He's also getting a a robo, so looks like he is going to be able to. We do have the drop going into the main base. It's not being spotted. The Widowmine is going down. It did not get spotted by the Koenigsegg, the Protoss player. He was able to actually get 7 probe kills, but it looks like the there's actually double Oracle going into the main base of John. He did not react terribly quickly. There's some Marines there, but they're not going to be able to take out both Oracles. He was able to get one of them. He does have a couple more that came out. He's flying over toward the bunker. Oh, he actually gets both Oracles, so really good job by John to get the Oracles. And he actually only lost 2 SCVs, so right now John's up in the worker supply 42-38, and his army supply is up 33-11. Looks like Koenigsegg is taking a third base, but he did a really good job in holding off those that Oracle harass, and he did get quite a few probes with that double Widowmine drop. So right now it looks like Koenigsegg is going into charge. He has quite a few Stalkers. Got one Sentry and sending an Observer across the map. But as of right now, the Army supply for John is 44-24, and the Worker supply is pretty even. And he's putting down his third command center. John's also putting down a second engineering base so he can get he can start getting double upgrade. Now he has a huge drop that he's moving over toward the main base that I don't know if that was spotted by
We've depleted a mineral field.
I don't think that was spotted by Koenigsegg there. That is a 4 medevac drop that looks like it wants to drop into the main base. Koenigsegg's putting down 4 more gateways, but if he can get a drop in there, take out these 2 pylons, that's going to take out all of the production from Koenigsegg. He is actually going right into those bases there. He's getting ready to drop in the main. He drops between the gateways and the gateways that are now being made. He takes down one of the pylons. He takes down the second pylon, which is going to completely power down all of his production. He's taking out the gateways. He's got 3 tanks in there. He's got a lot of bio at the same time. He does have pretty much just Stalkers. He's got one fake Phoenix or Colossus there. That didn't have to worry about that one. He does have some bio. He's stimming forward trying to take out the Stalkers. Looks like that pretty much going to be cleaned up, but he does have the one tank to fall back on. So the overall supply right now is 98 for John and 72 for Koenigsegg. He still does have that tank in place there. Probes were pulled. The only problem is there's no way to produce anything because all of those gateways were powered down. So he was able to clear that up, but he does have his third command center down. And the overall worker supply is fairly even. But boy, that did an awful lot of damage, even though John did lose most of his army. But he was producing more at home. His army supply lead right now is 61-26. And he moves moving over toward that third base. He was able to save all of his medevacs. So as this bioforce moves across the map, he's got all of his medevacs that he can move in and take out this third base. So just saving those medevacs with this bio, he's going to be able to move right into that third base. Army supply is 75-28. He's not going to have any problem taking this third base down. So John really wants to put this game away quickly and really hamper his economy at the same time. Now, charge is complete. He's got a couple of Immortals and he's got some Zealots, but with all those medevacs there, he's able to heal a lot of his bio. He does have one tank and he's got a couple of Marauders. So just losing that base in and of itself, he stems up the ramp. He takes out all the Marauders, takes out all of his army. There's one Marauder left. He takes down the pylon that's going to depower the Robo. And Koenigsegg's going to GG. John's going to take this game number 3. So John, he's able to bring Sonic Aftermath back after that game. So now we've got 2-1, so we've got a series on our hand. Yeah, John played that really well. That was one hell of a drop that he dropped into the main base of the Protoss player, and he took out all of his production there, and he was never able to recover after that. And I think saving those medevacs was really key for him, just to get those out of there. So Psionic Aftermath, they're not going down without a fight. After those first two games, they've taken game number three, and they're going to try to win this game, bring it back to an ace match. Hope you guys are enjoying the stream. My name is Kid Knot. First time I've actually streamed for Psionic Aftermath, but I'm enjoying the game so far, and I'm sure you guys are too. So stick around for game number four and see if Psionic Aftermath can bring this back to an ace match, or if Law B is going to be able to take the match into game number four. Zeno! Hey, Faith, I was actually in your stream today, and I was able to watch your last game that you streamed today. I don't know if you noticed that I followed, but I went in and I was watching your conversation on Discord last night. That was quite interesting. So, going into game number four and see which players are going to be trying to pull Psionic Aftermath into a game number five, or Law B wants to take it after this game and try and take the match. Oh, you did see that. Okay. So it looks like our fourth game is going to be on Abiogenesis. It looks like we're going to have a PvP, so definitely the map is not going to favor either one of these players. I know that a lot of these players, they like to veto this map because it's such a short map, and you know, you got all the little things that all your different races can do on this map, but got our one of our players got to get a little drink of water here, so we'll be starting here shortly. Well, so far we've had some really good games, and it was good to see Psionic Aftermath win that game number three, because we definitely did not want to see a 3-0, and actually it'd be nice to see Psionic Aftermath win this game and go into that ace match that we all look forward to. Oh, I don't know about that, Faith. I don't know. I didn't see anything wrong with it. Hey guys, give a good shout out to Warbuffy here. He's helping me out here, but he's being the moderator, setting up the lobbies for me and getting everything going so that I can try and keep up with the production part of it. That's the kind of a part that I'm learning a little bit more about, is the production and the overlays and some of that stuff. So bear with me on that, but I appreciate the help from Warbuffy. Okay, Faith.
Hmm.
So again, we'll be getting into game number 4 on Abiogenesis. We're going to have a PvP for our fourth game. Yeah, we won't do that again. Okay, getting ready to go into game number 4. Right now we have Law B up 2-1. You guys are gonna have to help me with this name too. Madiki? Help me out, guys, in chat. I need a little bit of help with the Law B name, but okay, so game number 4 between Sonic Aftermath and Law B. Sonic Aftermath actually able to take game number 2 to bring it to game number 4. Law B is up 2-1. And for Law B, spawning in the bottom right hand corner as our pink Protoss player, it is Madiki. And spawning in the upper left-hand corner, trying to bring it to an ace match, playing for Psionic Aftermath, it is Sippy Cup. So here we go. Got a quick scout for Madiki over just to see what Sippy Cup's up to. He does see that looks like both of them are taking double gas to begin with. So yeah, this is definitely an interesting map. It is a very, very short map. Shortest in the map pool. Looks like Sippy Cup just wanted to look around, make sure there wasn't anything down toward the natural base that that he needed to spot from there. So both players pretty open, pretty standard. Looks like Madiki, though, he's put it down a second gateway, and now he's got a cybernetics cord going down. And we pretty much have the exact same build coming out for both players, both putting two gateways down and the cybernetics core. So we still have a probe in both bases. They're both looking around to see what that text choice is going to be. We have a Stargate coming down for Madiki, and not sure if that was scouted by Sippy Cup or not. So it looks like both players are going to open up Stargate. Stalker comes out and takes out the probe for Sippy Cup. So we'll have to see. Looks like Madiki is going to open up with an Oracle. Starport's finishing up by Sippy Cup, and he is actually producing a Phoenix. So that's definitely a pretty good choice against the Oracle to open up the Phoenix. So he shouldn't take any damage from that Oracle. Yeah, I see Lord of Terrans is in here. Good to see you. So it looks like the Adept was able to get into Madiki's base. That was taken out by the Adept and the Stalker, but he was able to see the starport. So the Oracle is done. He is now going into a Phoenix. And finally the probe's taken out of Sippy Cup's base. And he's continuing to make stalkers. The Oracle does make it into the base of Sippy Cups, but the Phoenix is there. He's going to be able to take the Oracle down. That was an excellent opener by Sippy Cup to open up the Phoenix first and take down that Oracle, which did not get any damage done whatsoever. Looks like there was a full wall out for Medici, so he had to actually take out one of the pylons and build another one because he actually walled himself in. They're both still on one base, and it looks like Sippy Cup's going to go down now, and he's going to take a second base. While both of them still continue to make Phoenix, we have two more gateways coming down for Medici. So it looks like Sippy Cup was able to get his Phoenix in there and see the extra two gateways coming down. Right now, the overall worker lead, Sippy Cup's up 29-22, and the overall army supply is pretty much even. Continuing to build some Phoenix, and looks like Medici wants to move over with his three Phoenix and a few Stalkers. We have another starport or Stargate coming down for Sippy Cup. So it looks like he wants to go into his double Stargate production. Phoenix and the Stalkers are going to meet up at the base of Sippy Cup. I'm not sure where the Phoenix are for Sippy Cup, but he's going to need to get those back there. So he does put down a couple of force fields. There's the Phoenix coming in, and a couple of Stalkers get picked up by Medici. And so we still have quite a few Phoenix, but he's going to need to pick up the rest of those Stalkers. We got some more warp bins by Sippy Cup, so he's going to, looks like, be able to clean up the Adepts. And then they're going to drop the Stalkers. Still have three Stalkers left, and they're picked up again by Sippy Cup. So having those Phoenix on hand, he's able to clean that up fairly easily. And so the army supply is pretty much even, but Sippy Cup having that second base completed, he's able to take the overall economy lead by 33-22, and Medici is yet to start his second base. So we do have the Phoenix that have come over and go into Medici's base, able to take out the last Phoenix of him. He's actually able to take the probe out that was going to make the second base for Medici. So now he's definitely going to be down in economy, down 38-22 in worker supply. And looks like he's just going to need to keep producing units. Don't forget, he's got that double Stargate, so he can definitely go into quite a large air toss build. Still have quite a few Phoenix going across the map for Sippy Cup. So it looks like he's in really good shape here. He can go up and take out quite a few of these probes. There's not a lot left over for Medici, and he's going to be able to just pick up probes one right after another. He's in the probe line, and he's taking all of the probes out. He's actually killed 15 probes. So the overall worker supply is 44-15, and things are looking really good for Sippy Cup. He is coming across the map with some Stalkers. He does have one Void Ray. But the Phoenix, they're going to need to come over and pick up some of these Stalkers. He's actually forced Sippy Cup to pull his probes all into the main base. But he's actually chrono boosting two Void Rays out. And we do have the Phoenix trying to take some of the Stalkers out, or at least hold them off a little bit until those Void Rays come out. But the Stalkers are taking all the Phoenix out. Sippy Cup did not react in time to move those Stalkers, and he's just now putting his probes back into the main line. He was able to get quite a few Void Rays out now, and he also has some Stalkers there to be able to pick up all of the Stalkers with the Phoenix. And the Void Rays, they're going to be going to town on what's left over. And there's one Void Ray left. The Stalker gets picked up, and we have a GG. And Sippy Cup wins game number two. We're going into an ace match. So Sippy Cup, he did a great job in bringing Psionic Aftermath back up to 2-2, and now we're going into a fifth and a final game. Great game. So we get the ace match. Yeah, Faith, I think you're right about the Phoenix, because he was able to pick up those Stalkers and he had nothing left on the ground, and great job of those Phoenix. I think it was a great opening to open up the Phoenix against that Oracle, too. Yeah, Zeno. He's definitely obnoxious. So now we have the captains going to pick who their ace player is for this fifth and final game. So again, my name's Kidnot01, and you're watching the Sonic Aftermath and the Alpha Team League, week number one, with Sonic Aftermath against Law B. Law B took the first two games, but Sonic Aftermath was able to bring back the second two games going into this ace match. So just waiting to go into our fifth and final game. It's going to be played on Acid Plant, and just waiting for the captains to pick who their aces are going to be. So we definitely have a match on our hands. Yep, Faith, I agree with you 100%. I think it's hard with a PvP, though, because when you go into the Phoenix production, it's kind of hard to determine when to stop making Phoenix, because if your opponent, if he stops making them and you continue, it definitely could give you an advantage. I also like putting down the second Stargate, especially being up that second base. I think that made all the difference in the world. He was able to pull all those probes and have the Phoenix to lift all those stalkers, and then the Void Rays were able to take out the other Void Ray that Law B made. Oh, you did a great job, Sippy Cup. That was a fun game to watch. So again, we're just waiting for the captains. They're trying to get their strategies together, decide which player they want to go into this ace match. Kind of an interesting format that if we do go into a fifth and final game, they get to put a little strategy together, and they're probably talking behind the scenes and saying who they want to play the last game. Okay, looks like we're going into game number five. Yeah, I also like the probe that you picked up that was just getting ready to build his natural base. That was definitely a good move. So going into Acid Plant for game number five. We have to see who the captains picked for their fifth and final game. Just getting ready them to make sure that the races are picked. It looks like we're going to have a TVZ. Always an interesting matchup. Acid Plant is a pretty standard map, so for a TVZ, we can get into a macro game, and or we could get into a big rush. It can go either way. Sippy Cup PvP is weird on any map. So getting ready to go into our ace match. So we'll go ahead and introduce our players on Acid Plant. Spawning in the bottom right-hand corner, playing for Lobby, it's our purple Zerg player. It is Attic. And spawning in the top left-hand corner for Psionic Aftermath, our green Terran player. It is John. So this is getting pretty intense when you get into game five in a match like this, especially when one team goes up 2-0 and then the other team is able to bring it back. So give shout outs to both teams, but definitely to Psionic Aftermath for after going down 2-0 to bring it back and get into that ace match. So it looks like Attic, he's not going to do anything really aggressive to start out. Looks like he's just going to open up Hatch Gas Pool. We'll see if John's going to open up Standard into a Reaper Expand or if he has anything else in mind. Looks like he did open up right into one gas, so probably just a Reaper Expand. There's the Reaper, and the SCV goes down to the low ground. So pretty standard from both players. Definitely can be a good map for macro. The third bases, they're pretty easy to take. Sometimes they'll take this one or even sometimes that one, depending on you know, how they feel. Sometimes for the Zerg player, maybe this one's a little bit easier to protect with the creep spread because this is a little bit further away from the natural base than most maps for a macro game for Zerg, but we'll just have to see how our Zerg player wants to play this one out. The Reaper is out. He gets over to Attic's side of the base. And there was enough Lings out to push that back. And he's just going to go over to the third base and double check and make sure that Attic didn't take a really quick dirt. He goes back into the natural base. He's going to try and see if he can get a pro kill. There are the Lings there to push that back, though, so he does not get any kills. So we have a factory that has already done for John. He's getting his starport done and continuing to make Marines. Could be seeing a 2-1-1, and he's putting down a bunker by his natural base. Looks like Attic was able to get his third base down, so the Reaper was not able to stop that. Second command center is done by John. So as expected, worker supply lead is just about even. Got a couple extra queens coming out for Attic. Got the second barracks that's about halfway done for John. Looks like he is actually, he's got a couple of widow mines that he's made. He's put them down in his natural base for some defense. And so looks like John's getting a tech lab onto his factory, which he will be switching over probably to get a couple of medevacs out. Looks like Attic's taking a little bit of a worker supply lead and going into that third base, which is pretty much normal for Zerg. He does have some extra queens out, so he's going to get that creep spread going. He's got his overlord by the third base of John to see when he takes the expansion. So we have Stim on the way. We have a fairly early lair for Attic, and he's also getting a Banely Nest down. So that lair is just a little bit early off from two gases. He also has put down a Roach Warren. So it looks like he may want to just do a little two-base timing. We have a drop with Widow Mines that is coming down into the main base. He's not pulling drones. He's going to get a lot of kills. So he was able to take out a lot of workers and actually get a lot of Lings as well. So he got six workers and an awful lot of the lings, and he was actually should have been able to spot that baiting nest and definitely get a scout that the lair was morphing in. I don't think he's seen the roach warren, but he does have a tank on the low ground, so that widow mine drop, that did a lot of damage, and actually John was able to even up the worker supply, plus he has the mules. He's actually able to take the supply lead in the army by 28 to 12. So he's got his medevacs coming out. He's got a couple more tanks. And there's the Roach Warren that has completed four Attic, but he's also getting a Hydra Den and Baneling speed. Stim is on the way for John. So it looks like John's moving across the map with quite a drop here. He's got a couple of tanks and a bunch of Marines. It is spotted by the Overlord with really good Overlord placement. And he did see that because he actually moved the Overlord. So he's going to be moving his army down. He is morphing in some Banelings. But the army supply right now for John is 36 to 24. And the drop is coming in toward the third base. He drops his tanks. He's also got his bio in front of that. So those tanks are going to be able to absorb anything that is being brought over. That third base is being taken out by John. So he's doing a really good job. It looks like Attic was just a little bit late in producing any type of army unit. So he's going to be able to take that third base out. He's not going to lose a thing. And he's just going to be able to take the overall army supply lead 51 to 32. And now he's going to be able to take the economic lead also. So he's getting his upgrades while looks like Attic is making some roaches. So he does have some roaches and hydras, and he's got a bunch of queens. Looks like Attic is taking a third base in the other position, as I was speaking to before. The third command center's done for John. That's now going into place now, so he's going to be able to really get a good economic lead. It looks like Attic wants to double expand. He's floating a lot of minerals and a lot of gas, but he's not going to have the larvae to produce anything until those two hatcheries are done. So right now, the army supply lead is 65 for John and only 32 for Attic. So John has really got that those production facilities. They just cranking out Marines and tanks at the same time, and he is getting ready to move across the map, and his army supply lead is 75 to 36. He does a scan to clear out the creep. He's going to be able to take out this fourth base with no problem. See if he gets the cancel on that. He does get the cancel. The other third base is completed, but the army supply lead, he stems forward. The only thing he's got there is he's only got a few hydras there, and that bio is just going to melt those hydras. There are some bandings that came in, but they weren't able to do much. He's got four tanks. He's got the bio moving in. He is really putting on pressure onto the natural base, and there's just nothing here for Attic. And it looks John's going to be able to take this game and probably the ace match for Psionic Aftermath. He's taking out the Evo Chambers. The overall army supply is John 69 to 21. He continues to stim into the natural base, taking out all of the drones, taking out the natural hatchery. And he's still got the tanks seized up where the third base is going to be. And he's going to be moving into the main base here shortly. And it looks like Psionic Aftermath is actually going to pull out the sweep of the last three games. It looks like they're going to be able to take this match. He's taking out the second to the last base. And the only thing Attic has left is the main base. Looks like Attic was, he had enough minerals. He's trying to expand to a gold base here, but the army supply is 69 to 20. Looks like he's looking around for some more bases. All he needs to do is really move up into the main base because he really doesn't. He's only got 20 army supply. He's trying to get down some spine crawlers, but all he needs to do is really put those siege tanks in a good siege mode by the ramp, stim up the ramp, and he should be able to take this game. There he goes. He's stimming up into the main base, takes out some of the bandings they were trying to morph. We got a GG call by Attic. Looks like Psionic Aftermath John's going to be able to take the match and give them a 3-2 victory. So definitely a great ace match, and Psionic Aftermath pulls it out 3-2 after going down 2-0. So definitely a good final game there by John. So we will be back in just a moment. So I'd like to thank you guys for joining us tonight. Had a great series for the Alpha Team League week number one between Psionic Aftermath and Law B. Give congratulations to Psionic Aftermath for coming back after being down 3-0, or excuse me, 2-0. So my name is Kid Knot. Glad you could join us tonight, and we will see you next time.